Well, hello. My name is Ray Skinner. I've been ordained in the Anglican Church for 50 years. To mark this milestone, I had hoped to meet here outside at Tunbridge Castle with a few friends. For much of 2020, the world has been in a lockdown due to a coronavirus. People limited if they meet in buildings at all, just a very few, and even outside, just a small gathering. So in the end, just this time to mark this milestone for me, a little looking back, but mainly looking forward, most importantly, and why start here in Tunbridge. It was the main town near to where I grew up and where I'm now retired. It's halfway between London and England's south coast. My parents had been missionaries in China, but Dad ended up as rector of a village just up on the hill above Tunbridge called Bidborough. And it can safely claim, I think, St. Lawrence Church in Bidborough to be the first church in the whole area and therefore responsible for planting all the other churches that came later in Tunbridge and then, of course, later even in Tunbridge Wells. So, welcome to my 50th anniversary of ordination. The word itself means different things to different people. To me, it meant being given the task of sharing in leadership of the Church of Jesus Christ. Well, I'm going to stop talking and ask you to sing along a great hymn, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of Creation. The service it was recorded at was in March 2020 and actually in Westminster Cathedral, and no less a personage than Her Majesty the Queen of England, or the British Commonwealth, more important, because this is the annual Commonwealth service. So why not sing along with the congregation and a bit more after the hymn? Of course, I should have said Westminster Abbey, not Westminster Cathedral, but a great advantage of a recording is that you don't have to listen to it all. You can zip through the bits you don't want to focus on. What I'm going to follow is the old Book of Common Prayer and its communion service. First, the Ten Commandments. 500 years ago, Archbishop Cranmer thought it important that everyone should know them well, and that the commandments should be read aloud by the priest at least once a week in church. Maybe the world would be a happier place if that still happened today. As I read the Ten Commandments, you'll see on screen the window of another St. Lawrence church in Morden, South London. Two big golden panels with the commandments on them in Old English. Moses and Aaron pointing to them, standing either side. But at sunrise, St. Lawrence in Morden fills with golden light. And then Stephen Hills, rector today from St. Lawrence Bidborough, calls us to confession. Confession, an important part of prayer, as Jesus himself taught us. Here are the commands that God gave to Moses from Mount Sinai. I am the Lord your God, you shall have no other gods but me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them nor worship them. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, taking it in vain. For the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember to keep the Sabbath day holy. 6 days shall you work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the seventh day and made it holy. Honour your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not commit murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbour. You shall not covet. Lord, have mercy on us and write all these your laws in our hearts, we beseech you.
When we gather together in God's presence, we want our hearts to be clean before him. And so we take a moment to just think back over the last few days, and if there's anything we'd want to confess or seek God's mercy for, we bring them to him now in prayer. A moment of silence. So let us admit to God the sin which is always before us. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring us his pardon and peace, now and forever. Amen.
Now, a friend from student days in Durham, a canon of St. George's Cathedral, Jerusalem, no less, Garth Hewitt. He sends greetings and sings two songs. The theme of his second song will then be picked up by a friend made more recently, Bishop Precious Omuku.
Hi, my name's Garth Hewitt, and it's a pleasure to be part of this celebration for Ray's 50th anniversary of being ordained. Thanks for inviting me. I'm only 3 months away from a similar anniversary. I was Up at university in Durham at St John's College with Ray, I found it a time of inspiration, and Ray and I became good friends, and I'm delighted to take part in this event. First of all, a song called Rivers, Mountains and Trees says something about God, our maker, our mentor, and our muse.
Albuquerque dawns like an icon of praise to a God who paints pictures to brighten our days, who dances on the morning and opens our eyes, the God who's an artist, who loves to surprise. North Carolina, at the time of the fall, a carpet of leaves covers it all. Beautiful sunlight makes everything gold, brings shimmers of glory to comfort your soul. For the rivers, the mountains, and the trees, wind of the desert and walks by the sea, gold leaves in the autumn, warm summer breeze, like a holy touch of mercy that helps us to breathe. For the rivers, the mountains, and the trees. Passing Loch Lomond, heading up to Loch Ness, passing Ben Nevis, but the part I love the best, it's the awe and the fear as you go through Glencoe. Such a strict God as the mountains loom close. For the rivers, the mountains, the trees, wind of the desert and walks by the sea, gold leaves in the autumn, warm summer breeze, like a holy touch of mercy that helps us to breathe. For the rivers, the mountains, the trees. There's a tale that is told from the southern Sudan about a tree where all life began. It's strange how our myths and our stories agree. There's something quite special begins with a tree. And the hills of Jerusalem now disappear. They're wrapped up in concrete and they're buried with tears. Up north, birds are singing on a mountain by the sea. Happens to be where a man spoke of peace. Through the rivers, the mountains, and the trees. Wind of the desert and walks by the sea. Gold leaves in the autumn, warm summer breeze. For a holy touch of mercy that helps us to breathe. For the rivers, the mountains, and the trees. Mystical moment, speak to me still. From the church of St. Enedoc, next to Bray Hill, did I feel God breathing? Did the earth really shake? Centuries of prayer and all for our sake. Snapshots of beauty returning to me make me so grateful for all that I've seen. Images so wild in the surf and the rain. Oh, the power and the beauty from a stranger that's not changed. For the rivers, the mountains, and the trees. Wind of the desert and walks by the sea. Gold leaves in the autumn, warm summer breeze, like a holy touch of mercy that helps us to breathe. For the rivers, the mountains, and the sea. The rivers, the mountains, and the trees. Rivers.
I founded a charity called Amos Trust, which very much focuses on issues of justice, and we work in different places around the world, supporting partners in those places. One of the places is Palestine and Israel, and this is a song about Bethlehem in Palestine. Bethlehem is almost all now behind a huge separation wall. It's a wall of oppression that is very frightening, and the people live under constant occupation. Yet the amazing example of these people we work with, who are committed to working for justice and for peace, is a real sign of hope. This song was sparked off by an organisation called WIAN, which is a conflict transformation centre based right beside the separation wall. And its director is a man called Zugbi Zugbi, and right beside the wall, they're making a place of beauty. 87% of Bethlehem's land has been taken by the Israelis, and there's only one green place left in the whole of the area. So they're building an arboretum of trees and plants, trying to make it a place that people can come and pause and maybe be counseled and find some hope. One time they asked me to plant a tree there, and I did that with their help. And afterwards, Zugbi gave me a t-shirt which said, "No injustice will last forever." I thought those are wonderful words, hopeful words, that even though the situation is full of despair at the moment, one day hope will come, that wall will fall, and it'll be the example of those who've been committed to justice, to peace, to non-violence, even though they're up against one of the strongest armies in the world. No injustice will last forever.
No injustice will last forever. No injustice will last forever. No injustice will last forever. One day the wall will fall. And no injustice will last forever. No injustice will last forever. No injustice will last forever. The spirit will overcome. I've seen it here. And no injustice will last forever. No injustice will last forever. No injustice will last forever. One day the wall will fall. And you can make a difference, do something to change the world, raise your voice by the oppressed and make the world a better place. Let no injustice.
Precious, dear friend, or should I call you my lord?
Precious is fantastic.
Perhaps for anybody watching this, I need to explain. In my time as team rector in Morden, Precious turned up one Sunday wearing a dog collar and introduced himself as living in the parish, having just moved, but still working for Shell. How come you were working for Shell but wearing a dog collar, Precious?
Well, This was an inescapable outcome, having been born in the church. My father was a missionary teacher. And so even though I worked in Shell, I had the desire to serve more in the church, but not necessarily as a priest. I became a lay reader, and I thought that was going to be the ceiling for me. But God had his way, and I became a pastor.
Well, indeed. And the great help to me is a stipendiary clergyman. And of course, now I'm retired, but you went on from Shell to a few other tasks, work for other people. And I think your last post was Anglican Communion, was it troubleshooter or?
When I met Archbishop Justin in my former life at Shell. He was working at Coventry Cathedral and working on reconciliation. And some of his work took him to the northern part of Nigeria. We had problems in the southern part where, as Shell, working with the communities. And we needed to have some kind of entente, some kind of accommodation agreement. And so we invited Coventry Cathedral to help us in the conversations. That's when I met Archbishop. Well, he was Canon Justin Welby at the time.
He asked you to help him as Archbishop. He was Archbishop, and he asked you to help him with all these crazy Anglican provinces.
Yes, we had worked together in the area of reconciliation, and he felt I could be some help. So I worked as his advisor on Anglican Communion Affairs. When he went around all the provinces of the Communion, I went with him, and it dawned on him that two-thirds of the Communion was in the in sub-Saharan Africa. And that's where you have a lot of conflict. So the role I play now is as his special representative in areas of conflict.
Okay. Well, of course, as a youngster, 18-year-old, I was a student teacher in no less than central or northern Nigeria, Plateau province. Mm. And it was there that I saw a church that was prayerful across many denominations, not just the denomination that ran the mission school where I was, but it was putting prayer first and then sharing the gospel as churches together. And I was really impressed with that. Mm. You, of course, I think at the time were a teenager down in the eastern region, and the civil war was building up. You commented in a conversation we had just before this interview that you felt that somehow that the Anglican churches had lost a desire to pray and to be open to the Spirit.
Indeed. Yeah, indeed. It's not just the Anglican church. I must say the old Orthodox churches lost their way along the line. Growing up, as I said, in the mission compound, prayer was at the center of everything. There was morning prayer, there was evening prayer every day, and my father participated in those. Every Friday, if you didn't come to what they call a class meeting, you wouldn't participate in Holy Communion. So there was a lot of Bible study, a lot of praying. The Bible was at the center of it all. But along the line, we lost it. And so there wasn't any teaching about what Christianity had to give us, especially we lost the consideration of the agency of the Holy Spirit. We didn't teach that the Holy Spirit has been given to us for forever. Jesus said, "I'm going to be with you to the end of the age," and so we didn't remember that He was always there to attend to any situation we have, and so on. But then the Pentecostal movement came in and started emphasizing these things, and we started losing our members to the Pentecostal movement. That was when we woke up again and tentatively started reinstating Him, reinstating Christ in the center of things.
You remember how I used to eulogize about the church in the northeast of England. And I think I sent you this photo here. This was St. Gabriel, Sunderland.
Yes.
In the early 1900s, a prayer meeting. As the members of the prayer meeting looked up at one another, they saw flames of fire on their heads. Mm. And very much like the Pentecost experience in Acts 2 and 3. Sadly, of course, the minister didn't last long after that in the Church of England, and he had to leave. But anyway, yes, open to the healing power of the Holy Spirit, individual healing, social issues as well.
National as well. We went away believing that we could solve every problem as individuals, not coming together, not having that sense of an assembly and taking our matter to God. And when we did that in the past, God was always faithful. He is always faithful, and He would come. But we seem to have forgotten that experience.
Well, the song that was sung just before you came on was my friend Garth Hewitt. And he was using that verse from Ephesians chapter 2 about the walls of division. Mm. And he was talking specifically, I think, about the West Bank and the rest of Israel and the walls that are being built there. And of course, in other parts of the world, we have new walls being built. But I think St. Paul was really concerned primarily about racism, wasn't he, between Jew and Gentile in his generation. Any comment on that to finish?
Sadly, racism has plagued the church all through time. I have one nasty example within the church, the Anglican Communion in my own country. There was a certain Ajay Crowder, a freed slave, who became the first priest in Nigeria. This, we're going back over 150 years now. And he was consecrated at Canterbury, became the first black priest to be consecrated there. But unfortunately, the European priests who were working with him in Nigeria rejected him, wouldn't subject themselves to his authority because he was black. And poor chap was heartbroken. He resigned his commission. Some 2 years ago, Archbishop Justin, as we celebrated the 150th anniversary, at the Cathedral in Canterbury, knelt down, handed his staff, his crozier, to the most senior Nigerian bishop who attended, and asked for forgiveness on behalf of those priests who broke Bishop Crowder's heart. This is sad. And
it was Archbishop Emmanuel, by any chance?
No, it wasn't Bishop Emmanuel. They sent another church historian.
Yeah. Precious, we need to wind up. I'm trying to keep this YouTube relatively within time limits. Can you give us a blessing, please, as I say on behalf of all our friends in common, you know, our blessing on you and all that you're still continuing to endeavour to do for God's kingdom. Can you please give us your blessing?
Heavenly Father, your promise to us is yea and amen. It is forever. And you promised our Lord Jesus Christ promised that his spirit will be with us to the end of time. We ask, Lord, that you forgive us when we've forgotten this promise, and ask that you visit us again, Jesus, in a mighty way. Visit, come, Holy Spirit, and renew your church in this new age. We pray this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. God bless you.
God bless you too.
Time now for some more singing. This time from my first appointment as a vicar, St. Matthew's Newbottle, near Sunderland. It was 1986, and we had the privilege of leading worship for 4 million people. It was the live morning service that independent television used to put out each Sunday. Five of the children in the choir, Hilary and I, count as family. Well, back in 1986, here we go, we sing two psalms, 95, traditionally called the Venite, but in a modern setting, but then a chanted psalm, 81.
Now, a modern version of the Venite composed by the Reverend Richard Bewes, followed by a traditional rendering of Psalm 84 in the poetic language of the prayer book.
Oh,
Now, my reading for this film, read by Elizabeth Hills, Stephen Hills' wife, then my sermon from August the 30th, 2020, preached online for St. Lawrence, Pittsburgh.
When I think of all this, I fall to my knees and pray to the Father, the creator of everything in heaven and on earth. I pray that from his glorious, unlimited resources, he will empower you with inner strength through his Spirit. Then Christ will make his home in your hearts as you trust in him. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. Now all glory to God, who is able, through his mighty power at work within us, to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think. Glory to him in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Therefore, I, a prisoner for serving the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling, for you have been called by God. Always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together for peace. For there is one body and one Spirit, just as you have been called to one glorious hope for the future. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and one God and Father, who is over all and in all and living through all.
The title, the theme of my sermon is God has created us, human beings, to be in relationship with him and with one another. I begin with a story. It was 1966, and with a group of Christian students from Durham, we had organised a week's camp for boys from Sacriston, a coal mining village near Durham. The camp was on the west coast of Scotland. We'd been allowed to stay in the village school, sleeping on the floor like one big dormitory. In the picture, bottom left, the boy Paul, sitting next to me, left school aged 15 and went straight down the village coal mine or pit with what was for him a dream job, looking after the pit ponies. 50 weeks in the year, the ponies lived deep underground, pulling the wagons between the coal face and the lift shaft. Paul's job was to lead them along and then look after them in their underground stables, feeding them hay. 2 weeks a year during the pit holidays, the ponies were brought up to the surface and able to run on fields where they could graze grass instead of hay. Just one of the boys in the picture. He'll be getting on for 70 now. But it was 54 years ago. And the students among us felt Holy Spirit power as we shared the gospel, the good news of Jesus. When I got back home to Bidborough, I was reading the verses from Ephesians that we've just read. Typed out in blue at the bottom of the photo is the verse from the end of Ephesians 3, and I took that as a promise from God, guiding me on in my remaining years as a student, and then for 50 years now in the ordained ministry, learning what it means for us to be in relationship with God and with one another. But I want you to notice that in our reading today, we didn't stop at the end of chapter 3. We went on to the therefore at the beginning of chapter 4. Someone remarked at one of our morning prayer meetings this last week that that therefore is so important. What is it? It begs the question, what it is there for. Sadly, when the Bible was chopped up into chapters and verses, that all-important link was separated from the end of chapter 3 and the beginning of chapter 4. There is a clear consequence for when we allow God's Spirit to work in us, bringing glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations. That consequence is to live a life that measures up to the standard God set when he called you. If you have a Bible, just open it and have a look at the beginning of that chapter 4 of Ephesians, please. To live a life that measures up to the measure, that measures up to the standard God set when he called you. And then verse 2 of chapter 4 is all about personal behaviour with one another. Be humble, gentle, patient. Show your love by being tolerant with one another. Sadly, in the English language, the author Charles Dickens reduces the word humility to mean cringing abjectness, like Uriah Heep, who is always so humble, rubbing his hands together. Literally, humility of mind. St. Paul uses a magnificent word in Greek. It's 15 letters, something like tapeno phrosunes. It would make a great score if you were playing Greek Scrabble. It's a recurring theme of St. Paul's letters. Humility of mind is a hallmark of Christians. And then the word tolerance. Our little English word loses so much meaning, but forbearance is a better translation, as in the Authorised or King James Version. It doesn't mean putting up with bad behaviour, not bothering when society diminishes or contradicts God's commands. Just one example. And we celebrate marriage today. A great way that God enables us to be in relationship with one another, not only between a man and a woman, but with the children they co-create. Adultery is wrong because it not only breaks the bond between husband and wife, but between parents and children that they conceived. Sadly, of course, modern society trashes marriage as God intended it. And sometimes Christians are caught up in the consequences. Thank God, and through his cross, redemption is possible. There are, of course, glorious examples of children thriving with parents who were not their original parents, adoption or whatever. There are other ways, of course, we can be in relationship with each other, teachers and their pupils. Let's make sure we're praying a lot about the whole situation for them in the next few weeks. Carers in the NHS, carers in the community, local councillors, members of parliament. Through the internet, we connect to the global village. How do we live out our responsibility to one another? God called me to be a youth worker originally, and then pastor, husband, and now grandfather. How is he calling you to work out your relationship with him and with others? And I want to point to another important lesson from today's reading briefly. Verses 3-6 are all about unity, Christians together building God's kingdom. We are to work together. That means cliques within a church congregation are wrong. And even our denominations, different churches, Anglican, Roman Catholic, Baptist, Methodist, Pentecostalists, they're wrong. Maybe a solution to an otherwise intractable problem at one stage, but we need to get over them as soon as we can. And I'm very sad about Southborough Methodist Church, all boarded up now and ready for sale. Why on earth couldn't churches together in not only Southborough but Tunbridge and Tunbridge Wells take up this amazing resource of buildings and land and use it for God's glory? There was a great scheme being put together with the local YMCA to help young people with accommodation. Like the Quakers did with their building just behind the post office in Tunbridge Wells near Five Ways. But the scheme with the YMCA has fallen through. Surely, as churches together, we should quickly redeem the situation. In a post-coronavirus world, young people are going to be ever more disadvantaged by a deteriorating economic situation. Forgive me for saying, we don't need more old people's housing built at great expense in Southborough. I could go on. Huge challenges face the nations of the world in the coming months and years. What an opportunity for Christians to work for the glory of the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations.
So a change of location, this time to my home, or rather the garden of my house, and down in the bottom part of the garden, among the trees, we built this bunkhouse accommodation for up to eight grandchildren. Here we are on the decking of the bunkhouse. I call it the House of the Forest of Lebanon. Perhaps there'll be a chance to explain that before we finish. So to the Nicene Creed. And it was written about 400 AD, agreed by bishops in synod in the city of Nicaea, present, I think, from my old parish of Oman, Sultanate of Oman, a bishop from Sohar. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. He became incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He shall come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He spoke through the prophets. We believe one Catholic and Apostolic Church, and we acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now to a short time of prayer. When this recording was made, it was September 2020. I don't know when you're viewing it. It might be several months after we've made this film. But let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the world that you've given us, for its beauty, for its peace. Thank you for trees and grass and mountains and rivers and seas. Thank you for all the wonders of creation that we read about in Genesis chapter 1. And above all, thank you for creating us one another in relationship with each other and with you. We pray first for our family, whether nuclear family of husband and wife and children and grandchildren, or any other kind of family that we are part of, perhaps an adopted family. And most particularly, we pray for the family of the church, the family that Jesus himself inaugurates and continues to grow, million upon million, as the centuries pass. Lord, we pray for the well-being of your church, for its leaders. And Lord, we pray that we will play our part in helping our brothers and sisters in Christ learn more and more what it means to follow you. May our example be exemplary. Help us to organize our life according to your word and your commandments. Forgive us for when we try and bend the rules. Lord Jesus, we pray for our families. And we ask that in the generations to come, until you come again in glory, Lord, may your church be ever more true to the word that you gave us through the apostles. Help us to love one another even as you loved us and gave your life for us upon the cross. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for that wider world. Lord Jesus, we pray at this time, September 2020, for children and teachers in schools. This next week, children will be going back to school for the first time for several months. In many countries, some countries, of course, up in Scotland, they're already back at school. We pray especially, Lord, for teachers and for their protection during this coronavirus epidemic. And we pray for young people, Lord, that somehow they will be able to be responsible for their own lives and for those around them, especially old people like me. Lord Jesus, that they will find purpose and a renewed vision for what it means to live in this 21st century in relationship with one another, old and young. And Lord, especially for this whole issue of race that Precious spoke about earlier, Lord Jesus, that somehow the deep divisions of race that have continued for centuries, many, many centuries, will be overcome. And we will be able to recognize that when we come to glory in heaven, there will be a whole multitude of many nations. Lord Jesus, we pray for our world, and economically too, we pray that somehow governments will be able to establish a fair, equitable caring for one another. Lord Jesus, may the worst of making money for ourselves be overcome. May we be willing to share the resources you give us, especially here in the Western world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for those who are sick and for the bereaved. And again, Lord, we pray for healing in the wider aspects of our society. Individual healing, yes. Thank you for the National Health Service here in the UK and around the world, the different ways of sharing good health with others, perhaps that can't afford it for themselves. Lord Jesus, thank you for all the carers in our society, home visitors, those who clean our streets, in all the different ways in which our lives are served by others. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the example you gave us. Help us to serve one another, even as you served us. Last but not least, Lord, we pray for the children of our world. Lord, you told us that children matter to you. You even spoke about every child having an angel in heaven, bringing prayers into the presence of our Heavenly Father. Well, Jesus, in some nations of our world, it's 50% of the population are children. Lord, we pray that somehow those nations that are able to encourage the health, the education, for children to grow to their full potential, Lord Jesus, may this yet be the 21st century ambition of every government. Lord Jesus, we pray that those you've created, each and every one, will fulfill their potential and come to know you, Lord Jesus, as their creator and as their Lord and Saviour. Amen. Well, we need to move on, and I'm going to say the prayer of humble access now. And I'll invite my wife to join in as well. Thank you, Hilary, for joining. We've had the confession prayer, and so now listen to our Lord Jesus Christ, words of assurance to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. For God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. The Apostle Paul says, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. The Apostle John also says, if anyone does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defence, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and joy, that we should always and everywhere give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, mighty Creator and eternal God.
Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the whole company of heaven, we praise and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory be to you, O Lord Most High. Amen.
And I did want to explain the scarf or stole that I'm wearing represents the towel that Jesus wore at the Last Supper. And the design on it, well, that's from the Archdiocese of Jerusalem, when I was privileged to be part of that in Oman. And so to the prayer of humble access, we do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not even worthy to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord who delights in showing mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat this bread and drink this wine, that our bodies and souls may be cleansed by Christ's body and blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in your tender mercy, you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made there, by his once and for all offering of himself, a full, perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. He instituted, and in his holy gospel, commands us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we humbly pray, and grant that we who receive this bread and wine according to your Son Jesus Christ's holy institution
in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. On the night that he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave you thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Drink this, all of you, in remembrance of me." Amen. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you and for me.
Amen.
The blood of our Lord Jesus, given for you.
Amen.
And for me. And if you are partaking at home, doesn't matter if it's days, weeks, years after we make this video. It's in God's time, not Earth's little time. And we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so we pray, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out into the world in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Well, of course, we've had an Episcopal blessing from Bishop Precious, we'll now have the Gloria sung 40 years ago or so in New Bottle Church. Glory to God in the highest.
Thank you.
So to sum up, you've seen and shared worship with different churches that have put up with me these last 50 years. In Bidborough, near Tunbridge, both where I grew up and now again in retirement. For less than a year in northern Nigeria, where I tested out the Bible truths that I'd been taught and found them true. Then churches in the northeast of England, home for the first half of my adult life. First as a student in Durham and with many other fellow students, working with young people from the mining villages around the city. At one time, 300 or so involved in a rock opera based on Pilgrim's Progress. And then with Hilary. We saw God at work building his church up in Newcastle and then in Newbottle in the northeast. All the fun of seeing tradecraft develop working for justice in trade and in employment projects with northeast young people, working for gospel healing. I was on the Church of England General Synod for a few years. I like to think my best contribution was encouraging rich Christians to give not just 10% of their income to God and Old Testament standard, but more, much more. And in sharing the gospel in words, the great days of Mission England in the Northeast in the 1980s, with no less than Dr. Billy Graham preaching and 500 regional churches joining in. Just a straightforward gospel message using the resources God in Christ gives us, whether in preaching or in offering healing, individual, social, political, as Precious put it. God in Christ, serving his church and his world. Well, we left the Northeast in 1987 and went to Oman, where I was for 3 years, co-pastor in the church there. I learned new lessons about shared leadership, as well as experiencing life in what has to be by far the best and most attractive Muslim nation. While there, I wrote a book to help expatriate Christians understand their role as I told the story of the Reformed Church in America, 100 years of sacrificial medical mission there. Cross-centred mission. And then just before lockdown, I was back in Oman for the launch of an Arabic translation of the book, Christians in Oman. But thanks to my good friend Al Muatassin, Saeed Al Mawali. And the design there on the front, or we'd say the back of the book, but the Arabic version, there's Jesus, the Good Shepherd, rescuing the lost sheep. And that was the theme in the window of a church we were able to build there. Well, not just Hilary and I, but the church, the expatriate church there in Nigeria. And thanks to Sultan Qaboos giving the land. Please pray for Oman and its role in the Middle East generally, bringing peace and really clear, getting alongside one another as nations in our world. Then in 1990, to Morden, South London, we saw there a 90% white British community change to be less than 50% when we left, and the two big mosques just down the road from our church. In London generally, there are now more black Christians in church on a Sunday than white Christians. What an indictment. A few churches join in running meetings for better understanding between committed Christians and committed Muslims, with genuine friendship as the bottom line. My very limited understanding of the Quran suggests to me that there may be that in the Quran the cross of Jesus is not denied. And I dream still of encouraging Northeast Christians in such meetings of better understanding. Well, here we are now, back where we started, longing that the world our grandchildren inherit will be one, where God's love reaches everyone. Why not? John Lennon, the Beatle, dreamt of a world at peace, where there is no religion. I don't see being a disciple of Jesus being a religion, which surely means a man-made concept, as human beings perhaps reaching beyond themselves. But to be a disciple of Jesus means following one who gave up the glory of heaven, who gave up everything for me. If you are not yet a disciple of Jesus but want to be, or attracted to him, then please read about him in the Bible. I suggest look up Scripture Union's Word Live on the internet. For me, reading short notes on a short Bible passage each day is the best way to keep in touch with God's Word and his Holy Spirit leading. But I finish this summing up with a challenge to Christians local where I live. You saw briefly the Methodist Church all boarded up, ready for sale. Surely we can together put that great resource to better use than just money-making for central church funds. Why not a gospel, good news reaching out to young people, providing accommodation, a workspace, whatever. I'm trustee of a little charity called the Generation Trust. It grew out of the youth work in Sacriston, Durham. Remember the text at the bottom of the photo from the end of Ephesians chapter 3. Over the years, it's supported especially gospel care for children and young people. How about some pledges of finance to take on that property in the South Borough of Tunbridge? A resource given originally by local Christians. Garth Hewitt gave a plug for the Amos Trust. Good for him. I follow his example by plugging Generation Trust. I'm only asking for pledges at the moment, but serious pledges, to give some idea of how Christians locally can give muscle to the gospel by our care for young people in these hopefully post-virus days. My email will be here at the bottom. Also, I'm grateful to George Collins, who's helped to put this whole video together. We began with Joachim Neander's great hymn, Praise to the Lord. I note that he only lived to be 30. He died from TB. But what a great legacy he left to the world. I wonder what kind of legacy we will leave. A hymn to conclude. Immortal honours rest on Jesus' head. It was composed by a Baptist minister, William Gadsby. It's little known today. But for me, it sets the scene for the future. My future, for my grandchildren and for all my brothers and sisters living and departed, and those that I will be able to spend eternity sharing together what we knew of the great love of God.